Alright, we are now live. So, let's go ahead and do introductions. So, I will go ahead and start. I am Aaron. I am your fabulous GM. I am the official organized online play GM for Fire Opal. I'm also the GM of the award-winning, or Obsidian Portal award-winning Forgotten Sagas of the 13th Age. And I will be herding cats for this game. Daniel, you go ahead and go next.
Hi, Daniel Splitter. I've been playing this since before Escalation Edition 1, I believe. I play with one Ash Law, who is the open play coordinator who's working with Aaron to make this all happen. I actually edited this adventure, so I will attempt to not metagame and forget everything I read while I was going through the editing pass. Yes. Yeah.
Alright, go ahead and tell us about your character, including your one unique thing.
Okay, I am playing Rocknar Grimfaith, the half-orc cleric. His one unique thing is he is the founder and high cleric of the half-orc religion, worshipping strength in battle as the greatest virtue. His background, he did clerical training in Santa Cora with the priestess. He has the power of my fist compels you as a background, take that as you will. And he was voted most likely to be a zealot by the half-orc tribune. His icon relationships, one conflicted with the priestess, because while she appreciates his devotion to religion, she's not sure she likes his religion. One conflicted with the Orc Lord, because while the Orc Lord does appreciate the face-punching part of his religion, he's not sure about the rest of it. And one conflicted with the Crusader, because while the Crusader also appreciates the face-punching part, he doesn't like that he went to the priestess for his training instead of coming to one of the darker clerical schools that the Crusader had available for him.
Okay. All right. Gerald, why don't you go next?
Hi, I'm Gerald. I'm associated with Fire Opal and the fact that I am one of the only people that hasn't played 13th Age, but has been watching it for 2 years in a painful fashion. Somehow I've missed every single playtest. So, thank you, Aaron. I am playing Ciro, a dark elf barbarian, who has... One unique thing is I'm the only elf to have cut down one of the elf queen's great trees. I have wrapped my sword's hilt in its ever-sinewy, flexible fibers, and I made a lute of its wood. Sometimes I think I hear the trees when the lute's played. And I have a conflicted relationship with a negative relationship with the Elf Queen. I have a more negative relationship with the Lich King, for not obvious reasons yet. My backgrounds are, I was an initiate at the Elf Queen's Sapperling Guard. I then, through some unfortunate incidents, was a prisoner of the Lich King, and now I am a woodcarver of the Imperial Court.
Okay. Gordon, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Gordon Koo, and I just kind of stumbled onto 13th Age through Aaron's, I don't know if they, I guess demos you would call them.
Yeah.
I'm playing Kalud, a half-orc temple weapon master monk. His one unique thing is he's a child of prophecy. He is born of the light that has surrendered to darkness to restore the balance and defend all creation. Basically, his mother got the really crappy deal. She was a cleric of the priestess. She basically was found out that she was prophesied to surrender herself to cultists of the Lich King, and I am the result of that. So I have a positive relationship with the High Druid because I am a monk of one of the High Druid's monastic traditions.
Monk. Yes, monk.
I have a conflicted relationship with the priestess for obvious reasons, and a conflicted relationship with the Lich Queen, also for obvious reasons. Because both of those would kind of like to turn me to one side or the other, but I'm kind of steadfast in being right in the middle where I'm supposed to be. My backgrounds are, I am a thief catcher of the High Druid. I'm also a lore chanter of the Wild Wood. And my third background is a ritual herbalist of Abranthu Krafank, which is my monastic tradition.
Present that. Sorry.
Nice.
All right. Anything else, Gordon?
That means the claws bite.
All right, that works. I like that.
In common.
All right, cool. Jay, go ahead.
My name is Jay. I think I'm the only one so far that has not been not connected to Fire Opal in any way, shape, or form. I've been hearing a lot about 13th Age, and this is my first opportunity to play it. And thank you for that, Aaron. I've DM'd 3rd and 4th edition, both organized play and, pick up games here and there. My character is Tabar of the Stolen Eyes, a dwarf sorcerer. His one unique thing is that creatures that look at me see their eyes scaled appropriately on my face instead of mine. The reason for that is he started out wanting to be a wizard, and so he was studying under the Archmage, but kind of became attracted to an elven woman and kind of charmed his way into her life. She was a sorceress, and he was basically able to wheedle his way into getting power from the Elf Queen as a sorceress, as a sorcerer. But that didn't go over too well, and so as a result, the woman cursed me, saying that because my eyes lied to her. Decided that she needed to scratch herself. Sorry about that. That because I seduced her with my lying eyes, no one would ever be able to see them again.
Oh, nice.
That explains the curse, basically. And that's basically it. He's a spell fist, so he will hopefully be a little bit more upfront punching and blasting rather than standing back and shooting things. So.
All right. And Joel, go ahead.
All right. I'm Joel. This is the first time playing 13th Age. I've heard a lot of good things about it. So I jumped on Aaron's game to give it a shot. I will be playing Velnar. He is a human ranger. His one unique thing is that years ago, the Diabolist sent a succubus demon to infiltrate, seduce, and possibly even kill the Crusader. Velnar is the result of that attempt. We don't know what happened to his succubus mother. What the Crusader has done then, he shipped him off to a monastery so that he can train Velnar and send him right back at the Diabolist. His background as a result of that is he is a red monk of the Bleeding Thorn. That's just in the background. He's actually a ranger. He's also a witch hunter and a cultist. The cultist is just kind of to give the background to his Diabolist connections. Let's see. The icon relationships, the Crusader is conflicted at a 1 because he still is that reminder of his weakness. The Diabolist is conflicted at a 1 for obvious connections. And I gave him a relationship with the priestess at a positive 1. She knows his story and knows some good that he will do in the future, although Velnar does not know what that good is.
Okay.
All right. Aaron, I forgot to mention my icon relationships. They're very simple. Archmage and Elf Queen, they're conflicted one. The Archmage isn't happy with me because I kind of cheated to gain power, and the Elf Queen is not happy with me for obvious reasons, but I do gain power from the Fey heritage. And then I've got Dwarf King positive one because he kind of likes that I pulled a fast one on an elf.
All right. That works. So. Okay, so... let's go ahead and get started with the actual game. Let me tell you about the setting at the moment. All of you are on a flying island called Darkskye. It's a prison camp. This is where the most dangerous prisoners in the Dragon Empire are kept. They are mining magical crystals that are at the heart of the island. And I want to know I'm going to start down the lines. You can basically tell me if your character was a guard, if they were a prisoner, and if they were a prisoner, why they were imprisoned there, what they were imprisoned for, or if they were up on the island for some other reason. If you need some ideas, I've got a whole bunch of list of ideas that I can suggest based on your icon relationships. But let's go ahead and go down the line on that. And Daniel, why don't you go ahead and start us off?
Rachnar Grimfaith is on the flying island to spread the good word of his religion to the poor sinners who are locked up here. Whether he spread that through beatings or through favors, he does not care.
They're probably very receptive to that whole talk to the fist thing, I would imagine. It seems that kind of captive audience would be very open to that sort of religion. All right, so you are neither guard nor prisoner. You're on there on religious missionary work. Gerald, what about you?
There are no trees on the flying island. This pleases me.
All right. So you're there because there's no trees. All right, that works. There is a village on the island. There's a lake on the island. There's actually internal water reservoirs on the island. So it's not like it's a floating chunk of rock that there's nothing on it. There's actually, you know, a village and other stuff up there. So don't worry about that too much. Let's see. Who's next? Gordon, why are you on the island?
Khalud is here on official business as a thief catcher of the High Druid.
So are you dropping somebody off, or are you...
I'm looking for someone.
Oh, you're looking for someone. Okay. All right. And who are you looking for and why?
I am not sure of the person's name, but I am looking for someone who stole something valuable from the High Druid, and that's all that I am authorized to tell you at this point.
That's all you can tell me as your GM, I guess.
That's not all I can tell you as the GM, but that's all I could tell anybody who would ask me.
All right, that's fair.
It's basically an artifact of the High Druid that was stolen that I was sent to recover.
Okay. All right, so next is Jay. Why are you on the island? Guard, prisoner, or otherwise?
I am on the island because I was part of a makeshift group that was hunting bandits, and we captured the leaders of a particularly notorious set of bandits in the area, and they thought that, at least for the time being, that he should be brought to the island until he can be properly tried and executed.
All right. That makes sense. So you're dropping him off.
Yeah.
All right. Joel, what about you? Guard, prisoner, or otherwise?
Guess more otherwise. The administration of the Dragon Empire has noticed that there is some kind of cult gaining strength on this island amongst these prisoners. And they've asked, you know, like the Crusader or that kind of part of the Empire to see if they can do something, and Donard is there in response to that, you know, to that plea.
Okay. Right. So that's... What was that? Oh, okay. The cult of Rocknar grows every day. Yeah, it's, that's probably a good intersection right there. The cult in question is Rocknar preaching his day.
That could be possible. I mean, that's surely a possibility. Depends, I guess. I guess we're saying how the Dragon Empire views the cult of Rocknar, because that would be then, like, you know, we got to stamp it out kind of thing.
they're probably not quite sure what to do with it, because I'm sure that they're kind of concerned about the whole punch people in the face part of it, especially when he's talking to prisoners doing it. So they're probably not entirely sure what to think about it just yet. So. So yeah, you're investigating it with the potential to wipe it out if necessary. All right, so the adventure starts and the island is crashing. Now, tell me why you think the island is crashing. Daniel, why do you think the island is crashing?
The island is probably crashing because I tried to administer faith and blessings to someone in the control room.
And you punched them. I got it.
That might be it. They were telling me I'm not allowed to minister to the prisoners during their lunch break. I told them they need to have more faith. Blessings were given, and things got a little out of control.
All right. So the island, the island's not heading straight down for the ground, but it is lurching and steadily making its way towards the ground. But you're high enough up that you've got to walk before it actually, you know, hits. So Gerald, why do you think the island is crashing?
I don't know. But will it hit trees?
It will almost certainly hit trees, yes.
Good.
So you are completely unconcerned with the fact that it's crashing. You're just concerned about where it's crashing into you. All right. Gordon, why do you think it's crashing?
Based on my knowledge of the artifact of the High Druid that's missing, it may be very well because of that artifact, as it has a magic dampening effect.
All right. That's interesting. So, Jay, why do you think the island is crashing?
I don't know, but this worries me greatly because I'm not a big fan of flying. I wasn't really thrilled to be on the island in the first place, and this is kind of why. So the sooner I can either get off of the island before it hits or find some place to ride it out, the better.
All right. And Joel, why do you think the island is heading steadily towards the ground in a crashing-like fashion?
Clearly the cult of Rocknar is responsible.
You're more accurate than your character really knows. All right, so the island is indeed crashing. It's tilting and whirling below your feet. Cracks are appearing in the internal corridors. Magical barriers that are holding prisoners explode. Magic is radiating out from the heart of the island. All right, I'm going to have everybody describe a danger that your character is avoiding or dodging, and then I'm going to have you make a skill check to avoid that danger. So, and if you fail, bad things happen, so try not to fail. Or at least fail interestingly. So, Daniel, describe me a danger or obstacle that you're dealing with on this crumbling, crashing island.
Well, as prison doors begin to burst open, Rocknar is going to call out to the faithful and try to gather some of his forces. The danger with that would be people who don't believe in Rocknar's faith answering this call and surrounding him instead. So let's see. Would that be charisma?
Yeah, that'll be charisma and whatever your...
Can we go with the power of my fist compels you?
Yeah, I think that seems appropriate given your proselytizing.
Okay. 13. Oh, that's not. That's without level. So 15.
Oh, so 15. Okay, 15. Yeah. Makes it. Your DC here is 15. So, okay. All right. So, describe how you actually avoid that obstacle.
Ragnar sees, let's say, four or five people approaching him, and one of them seems to be a lot more not interested in harming things than Ragnar would like. You know, several of them are burly prisoners. They're pounding their fists. They're ready to go. And then this one guy has, like, a flower in his hand, and Ragnar knows that guy is definitely not a believer in the way of Ragnar. So he has the other guys take him out before he can get to him.
All right. Awesome. So you guys are running through the corridors, and you see a beam of magic hit somebody who's running at the end of one of the corridors. You see the figure explode, and fiery worms erupt from his body and disappear into the corridors to either side of him. So, next.
Not good.
No, maybe not. Next, Gerald, describe to me how what obstacle you guys ran into, and how you got around it. Or
I'm avoiding the tidal wave of water that's coming from the lake that's now been burst in half and is flowing into the prisons.
All right. Describe how you... go ahead and roll whatever check you're going to roll to avoid that, and then we'll head on into the description from there.
Okay, I thought that was going to roll.
Only 11. Do you have more to add to that?
No, that was the extent of it.
Wow.
Whoa.
All right. So in that case, what did you add to it?
I added my dex and nothing all else. Right.
Oh, you should add a background to it. Whatever your appropriate background is for.
All right, let's see. Let me think of a reason for that. You know what? Because I have been a prisoner of the Lich King, I've seen him drown people, so I have an idea about the fear there. So I'm going to add, plus 3 to that to give me a 14.
All right, 14 is unfortunately just short.
That's also not including his level.
Oh, that's true. That is
true.
A
good point. 16.
So 16 will do it. All right. Describe
it keeps getting better.
Yeah. Holy inspiration from Ragnar from you don't know where.
Yeah, you guys are at this point just running through because you happen to be all in the same place and you're avoiding the same obstacles. So at the moment, survival is your reason for being together. So 16. So go ahead and describe how you avoid this wall of water sweeping through that particular corridor.
I run quickly.
All right. It works.
And I found that a pile of prisoners slows the water down, so I keep pushing them into it.
All right.
Ragnar approves of your methods.
Oh, it's going to be a really interesting party. It really is. All right. So, Gordon, tell me an obstacle or some other thing that you guys had to avoid or dodge. Danger.
Basically, I'm running through the hallways, and suddenly, right in front of me, a wall is falling down, and I'm going to ground my staff and jump over the falling wall to get past the debris.
Okay, go ahead and roll your check. Dex plus whatever background.
Yeah, this is
or strength.
Complete. Oh, I don't want to use strength. This is totally within his thief catching background. He's had to do a lot of hair raising chases across woods and roofs and all kinds of horrifying landscapes.
That's fun. Go ahead and roll it. Ooh. Is that including your level?
Yeah.
All right. So you fail. You're the first one to fail. unless you have hidden numbers to pull out like everybody else has so far. In that case, let's see. Both you and Jay, Tabar, are getting caught under a under falling debris. Let's see if it hits either one of you. Christ Almighty! You have no idea. My rolls have either been 20s or 1s the last 2 days. It's been ridiculous. So, all right. So you guys are hit by falling debris, tons of falling rocks and crystals that are mined down here hit you guys, and it's going to be, let's see, 12 damage each. So you take some pretty good hits from falling rocks and stuff as you fail to avoid the worst of the damage. In fact, given that roll, you probably jump right straight into falling rocks. So let's hope I roll less natural 20s from here on out. Because I don't want to kill you guys all the first session. That would just be anticlimactic. All right, so Jay, it's your turn. Describe an obstacle or danger that you guys had to get through.
You mean besides the falling rocks that just hit me?
Yeah, besides the falling rocks. You guys are past the falling rocks now. Concussion aside.
All right, yeah. So I'm pulling myself out of the rubble, and, you know, we're kind of maybe in like a more heavily, you know, more of the fortified areas where they have like magical wards, you know, set up to prevent attempts at, you know, escape or being, you know, sprung from. So as the walls are kind of crumbling, the glyphs, you know, that highlight the protective ward start sparking and failing, and bolts of random energy are just starting to like shoot out of the walls, and you know, I see like, you know, a random hapless prisoner get, you know, electrified, and a guard gets incinerated. So I'm like, you know, trying to get as far away from, you know, get out of that area as quickly as possible while dodging bursts of random magical energy.
Okay, go ahead and roll whatever skill check you are going to do for this.
I'm assuming that's going to be dexterity?
Yeah, dex. Dex, okay. Sounds good.
Yeah, and I'm going to throw in the +4 for being for my failed wizard background, which I forgot to detail. That's on the character sheet. And
failed wizard plus dex. That seems like a good option.
Okay, and ability modifier is... Well, I'm gonna add the ability modifier and background both, so it's a total of +7, and... Why did it not fire?
We'd be back in time, wouldn't we?
My...
True.
Why did that... Did it roll?
You see it? It's not showing that... up.
Okay, let me try it again. So +4 and +3 for dex is, there we go.
There it is. 16. 16 means you are successful. You managed to not only get yourself through this whirling death vortex, but you get everybody else in too. They just kind of follow right on your heels.
Right.
And, so everybody else is okay as well. That's kind of nice.
Excellent.
As you're running through, you see a guard on fire, and the island lurches, and he's completely just impaled on a torch sconce.
Yeah.
And even if you wanted to help this guy, you had no chance to do it, because he was unfired and impaled with extreme prejudice. And Joel, you are up next. Describe an obstacle or danger.
Okay, right before everything started breaking apart, Bernard was on some kind of guard tower looking over everything, and now the guard tower is collapsing underneath his feet. I'm going to roll on a dex check with that, and I'm going to use his Red Monk of the Bleeding Thorns background.
Okay.
Oh, damn. That just put me right out of reach. And that's with all the creatures.
And that's including everything. That's with your level and all?
Yep, +4 on... plus four for dex, plus two for level, and plus four for the red monk, so that puts him right out.
Okay, so both you and Daniel's character are Ragnar, are
yes.
caught in this collapse. Let's see, what's the best one for this? I think that's it again. So let's see if you manage to get out of the way or if you're you're about to get more falling stuff on you guys. All right, just a second. So that's going to be 19 versus AC for both Ragnar and Velnard.
AC is 19, so that's a hit, correct?
That's a hit. How about you, Daniel? I'm sure that probably hits you.
Yeah, that's a hit.
Yep. All right, so let's see what the damage is. 13 damage to the both of you?
Oh, okay.
So I think the only person who has avoided all damage so far has been Zero. Is that right?
Yep.
Yep, all right, that's what I thought. But then again, the island is falling and crashing and falling apart, so it's not a surprise that you guys are running into problems as you're running through trying to find someplace safe. Sorry, my sister just texted me. All right, so. So you guys are somehow managing to make your way through this maze corridor, these mined out passages where they used to collect magical crystals for shipping off to the rest of the Dragon Empire. The walls of the mine still glitter with these purple crystals that are pulsing with magic. The pulsing, for those of you who have gone down into the mines before, it used to be fairly subdued and kind of a background thing. You didn't really see it happening that much. Now they're pulsing very powerfully, very brightly, and it kind of makes your skin tingle, your hair stand on end as you run through the corridors. Even if the rest of the island weren't falling apart and falling, it's a disconcerting feeling being down on these mines. Eventually, you guys end up down in the mine itself, the deepest parts of the mines. And you can tell that the island it's still falling apart, but it's not really falling, at least it's not really falling at the same rate that it was before. It was plunging down pretty heavily before. Now it's kind of, you think it's probably falling down a few feet every minute, if that, but it's still heading down towards the ground. Let's see. All right. Let's see. You can see a crack in one of the walls, and you can see that the island is kind of rotating, and you can see a forest outside the crack in that wall. There's a magical barrier that stops prisoners from escaping, and that is somehow still intact. You can see that it's still out there across the island, but you think that. Hold on, let's see. Let me reread this. You think that the island is pretty much unsafe to keep on or even keep close to. You know that these glowing crystals are they have to be really unhealthy to be around, and if you want to get out, you're going to need to find one of the mystic keys that's going to lower the barrier around the island. From around the corner of the tunnel that you guys are in, you hear some hoots and howls, and it's a group of prisoners and guards. They've all been wounded. Their clothes are in tatters. They have strange glowing eyes, and they're all carrying mining tools. They halt when they see you guys, and they're kind of just looking at you, at least for a brief moment. You can hear the heartbeats of these people, and they're somehow beating in unison as they look at you, as they stare at you. You can smell the sweat pouring off of them. It smells like sickness. It smells like death. And you feel something. You feel something even in your own eyes. There's something in the crystal dust that you're breathing in. It feels like your eyes are maybe even starting to glow themselves, just like the people that you're looking at. So these guys are looking at you, and they're not actively attacking you, but they don't exactly look friendly either.
Are they human?
They look like they, most of them used to be human. They don't look
used
quite,
to be.
They don't look quite normal anymore.
Do they look flammable?
Well, I mean, they're, everything's flammable if you get it hot enough.
Okay.
Ragnar, what have you done? Unless you wish to die too, call your men off.
These are not mine. Ragnar only have live people. These weird undead things. Get out of way, undead things. Go! And Ragnar will try to compel them to leave his presence.
Alright. Go ahead and make me a skill check. Use your charisma.
Uh-huh.
Whatever. Probably.
Well, I was thinking
probably the power of this compels you.
Okay.
And this one's gonna be hard.
So I'm guessing 16's not gonna make it then.
They don't look impressed, and they actually look pretty. They didn't look happy with you before, but they didn't look hostile either. But now they're looking angrier at you.
Ah, non-believers. We put faith into them.
Okay. So I'm guessing we're all rolling initiative then?
Sounds like.
Yep.
All right. Let me switch you guys' maps. Oh, that's the other thing I need to do. Let me make sure everybody has control of their characters. Gerald, there's you. Food, Ragnar. Everybody, your tokens should be down towards the bottom of this screen. Go ahead and make sure that you can move them. Let me move.
I'm not seeing that.
We're still got
the 13 troop.
Ah, sorry, that's my bad. I moved me, but I forgot to move you.
Excellent.
There we go.
That's a big map. Oh, there we are.
Yeah, you guys all should be down at the center and the bottom. So go ahead and make sure you can move your characters. You can double-click on them. Your hit points should be there. Your recoveries should be there. Your recoveries are the blue bar. Hit points are the green. So make sure everybody can move their characters and edit their characters.
I cannot.
You can't, Jay? All right, let's see. No, you cannot. All right, try now.
That works.
All right. Go ahead and move you guys back over to the center here while I get your newfound playmates ready to go. And, all right. And since you guys are starting the fight, the escalation die will start at one because you're catching these guys off guard a little bit. They expect to attack you and not the other way around. And, all right, so how many of you guys were on?
Wow.
I'm not even sure I want to go over and look at what rolls you guys are doing. I'm sure it's bad.
It's not great.
Jay.
Well, so, Jay's finally pulled off a decent roll. Gerald's roll is not that bad. but...
In this crowd, no.
Yeah, this is...
And how many of those are there? There are five. Bones. Threads. Ah! Fuck the wall. That worked. Alright, so, alright, initiative. Oh, bloody hell, are you serious? I could have sworn I did this. All the initiative that I pre-rolled yesterday just went away, apparently.
Oh.
That's unpleasant. So I have to do it over again real quick.
That's right.
I thought I was saving time, but apparently not.
Well, you would have if it worked. It's not your fault.
Yeah. If it would have worked, I don't know.
Technology has failed you.
Yes, it has. All right, so 1, 2, 3. I'm missing. Four.
I like those rolls.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that's not going to stay that way. Where the hell is 4? Or did I even put 4?
It's up at the top.
Yeah, I missed him. All right, so what are my initiative rolls? It's 5. All right, so no, not 222, just 22. I don't think you guys would like a monster that has a 222 initiative.
No.
I don't think it would go tremendously well. All right, so it's fine. We're all just in 2. I really hope all the pre-rolled initiatives I did for the other fight stayed, because otherwise that could be ugly. So, 6. Oh, come on. All right. And 6. Alright, so let me add you guys, and then you can give me your initiative. Alright, so Clued, what's your initiative?
14.
Alright, Rocknar.
3.
That's fantabulous, well rolled. 0.
15.
15's not bad. Velnard.
12, with the human reroll. That was a 12.
Okay, and Tabar.
19.
So you ain't going first, I'll tell you that. And Rocknar's lucky he gets to go at all with that roll. So, all right, top of round 1. Escalation die is at 1, since you guys have caught them off guard with your stunningly aggressive action. Even though if these guys had run into Rocknar before, I don't know why they'd be that surprised. So, Infected Brute 1 is going to run up after you guys, but he cannot make it to you. Don't worry about the what's it called? The bar. Grid on here. I have the grid turned off on roll 20, so you can move wherever you'd like. Don't worry about it for squares and so forth. And yeah, you can set your own initiative. I figure, since most of you hadn't played with Roll 20, I figure I'd just do it, though. So, all right, so he is done, and it is Tabar, it is your turn. Or how do you want to pronounce that? Tabar or Tabar?
Tabar. T-A-R. Let's see here. Well, let's see how lucky I can get. I am going to see if I can... I step forward kind of in front of everybody I can't move my guy. Oh, that's why. Yeah, so I'm going to step up in front of everybody, and I'm going to try to hit the brute in front of me with lightning fork and see how many of them I can catch with that.
Okay.
So, gotta move things around to get my. Okay. So the first roll, and if it's the way it works is if I hit and it's a well, it, actually, if I don't hit, if I make it, if my natural attack roll is even, then I get to pick another target to target. Right. As long as I keep rolling even attack rolls, I can keep going. So first one, infected brute number one is sufficient die is 1, 14. So natural is 14. So I'm going to try to hit number 5 behind him.
And is this versus AC or is this versus physical defense?
It's against physical defense. I've got it in the macro. All
right. Oh yeah, you did, don't you?
Yeah. So okay. So infected brute one, I'm going to hit. I'm going to try to hit mutating infected 5. Escalation die 1. And, okay, so it's just going to be those two that I'm
targeting. All right, so you will hit both, so go ahead and roll damage twice.
All right, actually, I think it's all one set of damage.
Is it all one? All right, yeah, go ahead and do it that way.
Should be.
It'll be faster anyway. And if it's and it's half damage on a miss, so.
Yeah, but you hit with both anyway, so.
Yeah, 12 so. Lightning damage.
I'll put your reference to that. So.
Not as cool as I hoped, but that's all right. Yeah, so I step forward, and I shoot a bolt of lightning, and it bounces off of infected brute number one and arcs past him to hit number 5. And mutating
okay.
Infected 5.
Describe how mutating infected 5 dies.
Oh, he does.
Yes, these are mooks.
Oh, okay, awesome. That explains why they don't have help. Yeah, basically the bolt just kind of catches him, you know, in the chest and kind of plays over him, and his eyes... you know, sparkle and electricity kind of, you know, flies off of him, and then he just falls over.
Okay. That reminds me, actually, do you guys want me to tell you up front when things are mooks, or do you want to just kind of figure it out yourself? I can do it either way.
You tagged infected 3 is dead, not 5, looks like. Here.
No, you're right. Sorry, I have to zoom out a whole lot.
These are the two that I was targeting, so...
No, that's fine. Yeah, I have to zoom out a lot so I can see everything. So sometimes the numbers get a little,
That's cool. Just want to mark off the right one.
Yeah. Let's see. There's not a big one. All right. So, that being said, anything else from, Tavar?
Some
action, I believe.
Yeah, I don't have anything I'm going to do.
So okay.
That was kind of my big shot. I was hoping to fry a bunch more of them, but luck did not bend in my favor, so.
Well, you hit a couple of them, which is
true.
Which isn't too bad, so. And he is off the turn order, so. Ciro, you are up.
There's that infected brute in front of me.
Yes. Yes, there is.
I think that he needs to go down and die.
Are you going to help him on his merry way?
I am. I hope.
So, Go ahead and move your token. So you can move your token? There you go.
That seems like kind of a low attack bonus.
Yeah, it does.
Wait a second. Oop. Forgot my strength. Plus 4. 17.
17, and that's versus AC. Unfortunately, 17 will miss. The AC you're looking for is 19, but you still do your miss damage. So you run up and...
Or I could enact cruel.
That's true.
Which and, I shall.
What does that describe for me, what that does?
10 ongoing.
It does D5 ongoing plus level. So 2D5 plus level. So.
It's 5 damage times your level. So 10, since we're level 2.
Okay. So 10 ongoing. And that save ends, I'm assuming?
Yep.
All right.
And I'll take the miss damage of 2 on top of that.
Yep. Already factored in. So you... All right, you nick him, but I don't know. How how do you want to describe that thematically or narratively?
Oh,
how does the crow
it was
work?
Just a flesh wound. A deep, deep flesh wound.
Yes. So he's bleeding out then. All right, that works.
And I'm smiling as he bleeds out.
You're a dark elf, of course.
He's anything infected. Else? I am moving my feet backwards away from the pool of blood, little by little. Gently.
All right. Kalud, you're up.
Kalud enters into his heaven's thunder form.
I really love monks. They're so much fun.
And flows up to the infected brute and attempts to slam his staff into the face of the brute.
Okay. Roll away.
That will be a 21 versus AC.
That will hit. Oh, yeah, you did.
I can do it real quick.
Yeah, go ahead and do that real quick, Jay.
Yeah, I'll lay them out first where the list goes. It's one on a 1 to 2, it's the Drow racial power. 3 to 4, it's High Elf. 5 to 6, Wood Elf. And I'm rolling 1d6, and it is 4. So I've got Highborn Teleport.
Okay. So go ahead and roll your damage, Gordon.
And this is a backhand damage. The first one, obviously. Oh,
okay. So 11 more.
I double. So I do 11 damage to him, and until the start of my next turn, I deal 4 damage to each foe that attacks me.
Okay. Alright, so he is staggered.
So I slam my staff into his head and fall back into a ready position where I can hit anybody who tries to come after me.
Okay. That works. So, just for notes on roll 20, I use the red dots for staggered, and I use the green dots for ongoing damage. Just so you guys know, so I don't have to announce something is staggered all the time. Although I'll probably end up doing it anyway, just for out of habit. Anyway, anything else from Kalud? Anything else? You saw the quick action, I think.
Kalud is done, but he's also 1 AC till the start of plus 1 AC till the start of his next turn because he used an open attack.
Okay. So don't forget that if you get attacked.
I will not.
Vilnard, are you up?
These walls, are they? I mean, they look like ruined walls to me from the map. Is that what the case is? How high are they?
They're not terribly high. This used to be clearly some kind of mining camp that used to process the crystals and stuff like that. So, but it's been long abandoned. So they're none of them are more than 7 feet high, but most of them are crumbling. If you attack anybody that's behind a wall, you can still attack them. They're just going to get cover from it.
Okay. Vilnard is going to attempt to run up to a wall and jump on top of it. Should I make a roll for that, or is it just going to happen?
Go ahead and make a roll for it.
Okay,
dex plus whatever your best, most appropriate background is.
Red monk training, of course.
Yeah, that works fine.
So
you're fine. You managed to clear the wall, no problem.
Okay, how far can I move on this? Okay, can I move to here?
Yeah, you can move there. That's about as far as you can go.
Okay, so Vilnard runs towards the wall, leaps into the air, somersaulting, landing on the edge, running across, drawing his two hand crossbows, and I'm going to try to go for mutated infected number 3.
Okay. So you'll have a clear shot at him.
Okay, I rolled an 18, which means then with the double range, I can get a second attack.
Yes.
Would I decide the second attack now before I know the effect of this, or do...
Well, you're firing at a mook, so whatever damage you're going to do is going to carry over to...
To any other mook, but he might...
Yeah.
He might attack the brute with his second attack. Go ahead and make your second attack, and then we'll decide the effects.
Okay.
Well, it has the effect of missing.
Yeah. Well, no, yeah. The effect of two damage. The effect of two damage.
That's true. It is two more damage. So go ahead and roll your damage for your hit, because you obviously did hit.
Okay, so 8 for the hit plus 2 for the miss, which is still a hit. That's a total of 10.
10 damage. Okay, describe how... Describe... No, that's not it. It's... There we go. All right. Should be... Yes. All right, describe how mutating infected 3 dies.
Okay, so the Nod, after doing the somersault onto the wall, runs across, slides along the edge, stopping just before the break, draws the two hand crossbows, shoots them, and 2 bolts right in each eye.
All right, that works. So, there's 2 mooks dead. Anything else from Belnard?
No, I think that's all for him.
Okay. So, Infected Brute 2, where the hell are you? There you are. He's going to come over here. He's not going to quite reach you guys. Infected Brute 3 is... He can get to Velnard, but he can't attack.
Okay.
Let's see. And 3, Mutating Infected 3 is dead. So. Infected 2, Mutating Infected 2. You see this guy, you can actually see his veins glowing under his skin, lighting him up from the inside. His bones are twisting as he lurches towards Velnard to attack, swinging his rock hammer. Oh, wait. I forgot about that. No. Then again, I didn't. So rock hammer is... 24 versus AC, I'm pretty sure hits. Yeah, so, take 6 damage as he slams his hammer into your leg. Let's see. Mutating Infected 4. Where the hell are you? You're way the hell up there. That's why I keep forgetting about you. He lurches his way towards Collude, but can't quite make it. It's really disturbing watching these guys... walk towards you. Their very bone structure seems completely out of whack. Not to mention, you know, the whole glowing from the inside thing. That's kind of not right either. Mutating Infected 1 is going to... He can't quite get to Kalu, but he's going to attack Ciro with his rock hammer. That's going to be 12 versus AC, which I'm pretty sure misses.
I'm most unhappy. He swung at me.
Yes, he swung and a miss. And
this is what enemies do, Ciro.
Ragnar coughs a little bit of the dust from his lungs. That's what slowed him down. Runs forward to engage the brute. And encourages his allies to finish this battle quickly. I'm going to use my invocation of, let's see, it's war, to increase the escalation die by 1 right now.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That is arguably by far the best escalation. I mean, the best invocation.
And then I'm just going to basic melee his face.
Okay.
And 20 does hit, yes?
20 does hit, so for 14 damage?
14 damage, yep.
All right.
Oh, that was good. I just saw the 1. I thought that was the 1 that you rolled.
No.
And somehow, despite despite your brutal attack, he's still on his feet, swaying. And then it's the top of the round, and he falls over dead. Because he takes 10 on his turn.
And the escalation die should now be 3.
Yes, it will. Alright, so it is top of the round, top of round 2, the escalation die is at 3. Infected brute 1 succumbs to his, to the cruel, cruel stabination from Ciro, and he falls to the ground weak from blood loss and expires very shortly thereafter.
What color is the blood?
It is glowing faintly red.
But it's glowing.
Yes, it's definitely glowing.
This is not usual.
And, Tavar, you are up. The infected brutes, you can actually see the crystals glowing under their skin. The other guys, you can see their veins, but these guys, you can actually see the crystals.
So from where I'm standing, can I see that Velnard has kind of got people ganging up on him?
Yes. Yes, you can.
All right, so I'm going to use High Blood Teleport, and I'm going to teleport... Oop, hold on a second. Wrong tool. And I'm going to teleport right behind the brute.
Okay.
No, that's not it. There we go. Yeah, so I just kind of shimmer, and I take a step and kind of shimmer into nothingness and step out of nothingness right behind the two. And then I'm going to use Burning Hands on... Right. I'm going to try to hit both of them. And my macro... Okay. That it only hits one because it's going to auto roll damage, but take the first damage roll. Where's
okay.
I'm just going to roll twice to hit. The escalation die is 3, the first roll. That's for the brute, and this is for the mook.
Okay.
And we'll take the first fire damage.
Let's see. That's versus physical defense. The 16 will hit, so you hit the brute. You do not hit the mook. And what was the first damage? First damage was 9.
Yeah.
Okay.
And on a miss, I do... am I considered engaged with both of them if I'm standing right behind him?
Yeah, you're considered engaged at this point.
Okay. Because of the spell fist feat, I add my charisma modifier to damage from missed attacks. So he's going to take 3 fire... The mook's going to take 3 fire damage. Since I'm engaged with
him. Okay. All right. Where's head with turns? All right. So your blazing flames lick at both of them, but neither one perishes. But they smell kind of unpleasant when burned. And not even the usual burned flesh smell, but they smell kind of like chemicals that have been burned.
Okay.
Anything else? Is there anything else you can do?
No. I don't have any protection, so...
All right. And Ciro, you are up. You are engaged with infected number 1. Congratulations. I hope it's a lovely wedding.
I'm going to take my greatsword, and I'm going to aim for severing its legs from the rest of its body.
Okay.
Roll this away. Is not an exciting roll. Oh, yes, it is. Never mind.
22. All right. Go ahead and roll your damage.
Maybe I should have killed the animations.
Oh, you've got the animations gone? Yeah.
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 Let's take 12 points of damage on
12
him.
Points of damage. All right. Describe how he dies.
I cleaved his left leg, proceeded up towards his right lung, and then severed his arm, cleaning him nice in half like a piece of sushi.
Well, I think he's more than just in half at this point. I think he's in, what, 4 pieces?
Yes. So yeah. Why don't I use my barbaric cleave ability at this point? And let's go after infected brute number 2.
All right. Go ahead and move yourself over.
Because they may not have any common sense, but let's see what happens. I've got to kill that enemy.
Barbarians are so much fun, too.
Oh, dear.
Oh, wow. All right. So your damage is maxed?
Yep. Which is 2d10 plus 4.
It is supposed to be the last mooks in the mob, but for this, in this case, I'll let it go. For here on, from here forward, yeah. It only works on the last mook in a mob, but that's okay.
The review did not get in before the next play.
Yeah, that, exactly. That's actually how I work it. If a roll has been made, it's not you can't take it back.
Okay. So I take my greatsword, I lift up, and I shoot right down through and pry him open.
All right. So roll your damage, and you can double it. Or you can roll it twice.
Hold on a second. Okay, maybe I do like the die looking the way they do. Oh, that'll work. 46.
46, all right. Your description on how you hit him is how he dies. You just eviscerated him in a single hit.
Aww. Bye-bye. And
can you use the Brutal Cleave more than once in a turn? Or is it just
no, once it's per once turn? Per battle.
Okay. Okay.
As a free action, that's all you got. Once per battle.
Yeah, I've never seen
I'll
someone.
I'll just retcon that hit. In my head as he hit the brute first and then cleaved the mook.
That works.
That's my head cannon now.
It's your totally retcon bad. is sufficient. All right. Anything else from Ciro?
No, I think that's enough for today.
Okay. Kalud, you are up. The brute you were fighting is now dead.
Kalud will shift into his Claws of the Panther form with a growl. And he will slide up in between the two infected so that he's engaged with both of them. And then he will unleash his flow attack of Cat Between Hounds.
This is part of why the monk is so cool. You get to say stuff like Cat Between Hounds. That's not like that's a lie. Except the roll. Do you attack both of them with that, Gordon?
No. I'm attacking three at the moment.
Alright.
If I would have rolled a natural 16 plus, I could have attacked a second target.
Okay.
But obviously.
Either way, you have missed, unfortunately. So
I still do half damage on this attack.
Okay, go ahead and roll it.
So it'll be 7 damage to infected 3.
Okay. Describe how he dies. The joys of mooks.
Swung my staff up between his legs, and I slipped a little bit, so I didn't think I got as good a blow as I thought, but I hit just right to lift him off the ground and into the wall that Velnard is standing on top of, and he collapses.
All right. Anything else from Clued?
Oh, well, might as well, even though the other guy is dead, I'm going to use a free action to spend a key point and do 10 damage to each engaged foe.
All right, so 10 to each engaged foe?
Yeah, right. which is only infected 4.
It's still enough to kill him, so go ahead and describe how that works.
Well, after I slammed his brother into the wall, I spin back with my staff, and the tip of the staff goes right into his temple, and he just crumbles to the ground.
All right. Let's see, who's up next? Velnar, you're up next. You are engaged with the last infected brute.
Velnar jumps over him. Get to re-ob him. And attempts to get two shots into him. Let's see how he does.
Okay, are you trying to disengage?
No, I'm engaged. I'm just trying to get to his... I mean, it's mainly for fluff.
Okay. That's fine. I just need to make sure you didn't need to roll something. Yeah, that's the other thing that was going to come up. Do hand crossbows provoke an attack of opportunity? Are they specifically something you can shoot in close combat without provoking?
I think the way the rule reads is if I am attack somebody that I am not engaged with.
You are engaged with the infected brute, though.
Yeah.
So you can move around him. I have no problem with that, as long as you stay engaged.
All right, that's a natural 20.
Okay. Well. All right. Let's step it back a bit. He's going to get an attack of opportunity on you for trying to shoot him from point blank range. And then you're going to get your nat 20. So let me go ahead and roll that attack real quick.
I could be wrong, but I thought it was if I'm attacking somebody that I am not engaged with.
But that's just it. You are engaged.
You are engaged with the brute.
And if I attack somebody that I'm not engaged with, I incur an attack of opportunity. I am engaged with the brute. I attack the brute, thus no attack of opportunity.
Yeah. I'm going to... I think he's actually got it right. I'm going to double check that.
Yeah, I'm going to look that up too, so I'm not sure.
Yeah, I have no idea at all, because I don't think any of the rangers that I played with in the two demos that I was in ever got engaged.
Yeah, I haven't had it come up, which is why I'm not sure about it.
I'm just curious.
Yeah, I want to look at it real quick and make sure that it's that it goes okay from here forward. Let's see. Yeah, okay, yeah, you are right. So, all right, so he doesn't get an attack from opportunity. Go ahead and roll your damage.
So it's max damage? How's it go again? Do you roll
it? It's double damage.
Double
you can
damage.
Either roll it once and double it, or you can roll it twice.
All right, I will multiply times 2.
Yeah.
So that's 18.
Okay.
Also, because it's an even number, he gets the second attack off.
Okay.
Okay. 17, that's probably a miss.
17 does indeed miss, but you still do 2 damage for the miss.
So a total of 20.
Yes. All right, anything else from you, Velnard?
No, that's all.
Okay. Infected Brute 3, it's his turn. He is going to try to smash the puny human who just shot him into the ground with his giant fists.
I no get to hit you before I hit you now.
Actually, no, he's going to make a frenzied attack against each one of you guys. So this is going to be attacking Tabar and Velnard. First is Velnard. This is going to be versus AC. So 14 on Velnard.
It's a miss.
And... nat 20 on Tabar. So, let's see. That will be 10 damage on Tabar.
Okay. As a free action after being hit by an enemy attack, I want to use That's Your Best Shot to basically get a recovery now.
Okay. Go ahead and do that. Go ahead and roll it for you.
Go, Dwarven Racial Power.
And you're actually knocked back as well.
Okay.
You pop free.
All right. Yeah, so he lands a big... So I get 10 back. So how much damage did I take?
You took 10.
Okay, so it cancels it out, basically.
It cancels it out.
Okay.
So he pops.
Yeah, so he throws me back, and I, you know, kind of land, kind of, you know, the three-point landing, and kind of wipe my mouth, and I'm just like, you know, now I'm pissed.
All right. I think that's all he can do. Yeah, unfortunately. All right. Rocknar, you are up.
Rocknar is going to run over, and before attempting to smash this thing's face in, is going to place a hand of encouragement on Velnard, telling him that if you don't kill this thing, Rocknar might have to put the faith in you. You can spend a recovery.
Thank you. Velnard, knowing how he converts people, tries to feel better.
Feel better or else.
Drive-by yes. Healing. Great.
Does 19 hit?
19 will hit.
Okay, 8 damage.
All right. He is somehow still up and moving, but it looks like a strong breeze would blow him over. Top of round what? I don't even remember now.
Round three.
And the escalation dies at 4. And Tabar, you are up.
And Tabar, it's time to provide that strong breeze.
The strong breeze?
That knocks the brood over.
Oh, yes.
I love the...
Give him a kiss.
That's right. No,
don't hug him to death.
Yeah, so I... Hold on a second. I'm going to use Chaos Bolt and I get a benefit, so I got to pull up the book real quick here to figure out what that is.
While you're doing that, look at the Q&A, guys.
Is there an actual Q&A?
Yeah, there's... Technically, the Q&A app is running so people can ask questions. The questions all so far have been about Greece.
Where's this Q&A?
It's an app on the left. It's called Audience Questions.
Yes, right. I'm very interested in hearing Rocknar's theories on Greece.
Yes. Greece has been very silent in the international arena. I think Greece is
the word.
Oh, no.
There have been two questions, both about Greece. It's fucking hilarious, I have to tell you.
All right. Where's my stupid... it's the same thing as gathering power. So it's one day... So I'll just do a little bit of this. I didn't account for this. 5 means I deal damage equal to my level to one nearby enemy. So he's going to take 2 off the bat.
Okay.
And then Chaos Bolt. Oh, and I get to... Okay. It's... Should I just roll randomly to see what kind of damage it is? Because I don't know if they've got any resistances or anything where it matters.
In this case, it doesn't really matter.
Okay.
Future fights, you'll probably want to roll, but in this one, it doesn't matter. Roll.
It's easier. I got a 3 that makes it lightning damage. So... Right. Exclusion die is at 4, so... Ugh. 10 versus physical.
Natural 1.
Oh, ugh.
But
he does take 2 lightning damage on a miss, so he's taken 4 so far. 2 from the...
Right. Nice damage on a natural 1. Sorry.
Oh, oops, okay. Sorry.
I'm not going to do it here, but in my home game... I tend to, if someone rolls a natural 1, I give them 2 bad choices for something to do.
You can do that. I'm okay with that.
Is everybody okay with that? I mean, it's not strictly in the rules, but if everybody is okay, I'll do it.
That's fine by me.
In that case, tell me which one of your comrades that are engaged with the brute did you just nail with a lightning bolt? Did you get Velnard or did you get Rocknar?
You know what?
I know my choice.
I'm going to leave it. No, you know what? I'm going to even make it more fun. I'm going to leave it up to the whims.
One, it's Velnard. Two, it's Rocknard. It's Velnard. So yeah, the so does he take the? Are you saying he's taking the damage?
He's taking the damage. How much damage did you roll on that anyway?
I rolled five.
Five. All right. So Velnard, take five damage as you're shocked in the back from an errant chaos bolt from Table.
The island lurched just as I was about to cast and scything out and hitting Velnard in the back.
Yeah, I love doing that. It's something I picked up from Dungeon World, is give a hard choice if you fail.
Yeah, that sounded Dungeon World-y.
Yeah, I really love doing that. But alright, anything else from Tavar?
Other than muttering an apology, no.
No.
He curses to himself, and it's just like...
Well, Tabor was the first dead to assist Velnard, so it's okay, it's cool.
Ciro, you're up.
We only have one mob left.
One mob with one hit point left.
Wait, Aaron, does he still take the two from the chaotic side benefit? Did you count for that?
Yeah, that's after that one.
Just checking.
He had three before.
All right.
Rocknar is encouraging Ciro to not critically fumble.
I don't know if I can take it.
In my home
something
game,
I forgot to. Go ahead.
In my home game with the natural fumbles, I've had two people shot in the ass with arrows and another person stabbed with an errant dagger.
Well, I guess I will run over. One thing I forgot to mention, Ciro is also a very short elf at 5'4". And he's just going to skirt right around that wall, slide between Rocknar and Velnard, and just right between the legs of the infected brute. We'll see how this works.
He's dying either way. The question is whether he dies really cool or whether he dies kind of wussy.
Oh, I think he's going to die really cool.
He dies really cool. You don't even need to roll your damage. Describe how he dies really badly.
I slide between him and splay him in half, with one half falling up next to Velnar and the other half falling next to Rocknar.
Nice.
And I turn around, stop myself with the sword.
All right.
Rocknar likes your style.
Anybody? All right. You guys have. You can take a short rest. You can use recoveries if you like. If you need to. I'm think any of you are staggered.
I'm staggered. So how does the recoveries work again? I mean, I used one because of Rocknar's heal. You just like keep using them and roll them up like until you get to max? Is that it or?
No. You can. Are you below half health right now?
36 out of 32, so no.
You don't have to use your recovery, but you can. In that case, you can either take the average of your recovery roll, or you can roll it to heal up. Right. But you don't have to unless you're staggered.
I see.
I'm thinking loot the bodies. Hey, they might have something.
Unfortunately, we don't have anything terribly... Oh, you know what? I forgot to have everybody roll for their icon relationships at the front. Go ahead and everybody roll. Give me your icon relationships now. Just roll a d6 for each point in each one. If you can distinguish them so I know which one you're rolling for, that would be great. Because this is a perfect opportunity for me to give you guys stuff that you should have gotten at the beginning.
Okay,
so mine are going to be in the order they are on my sheet. So Priestess, Orcler, Crusader.
Okay. So Priestess, yes. Crusader, yes.
Yep. I got a 5 for Elf Queen, conflicted.
Okay.
5 Elf Queen.
Jay, you find If you find something, I need to look up the magic item.
Not so much. Oh, that's right.
Hey, Aaron, is the blue bar supposed to be our recoveries?
Yes. The blue bar is your recovery. So if you've spent one, go ahead
and do that. It's not allowing me to edit the default value in the blue bar. It's set to the same as my HP right now, so I can't set it to 7 and out of 8.
Is it written? Hold on, let me check that.
Yeah.
Where's your ticket? Oh, that's odd. Try now. Is that better?
Yes.
Okay. Excellent.
No, it's still not letting me change it. It's,
really? Yeah. Bar 2 edits. That's very odd.
Let me try changing it straight from here. Nope, it changed it right. It changed it like for half a second, and then changed it right back.
That's incredibly odd. I'll change it for you, and then I'll mess with Roll 20 later and see how it works. Anybody else having the same problem?
I haven't tried it.
Mine works fine.
Okay. Yeah, that's really odd because you should have.
Minus one, and it subtracted from mine.
Yeah.
Try messing with it now, Daniel.
There we go.
Is it working now?
Yep.
Okay. That's...
I took two of it off now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can fix that back up, though. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, for whatever reason, it's supposed to be... That's supposed to be bar 2, but I had to give you permission for bar 3.
Weird. Okay.
That's another bizarre bug, so really, really odd.
Good to know now.
Loot. Alright. Where?
Yes.
I really wish I'd been able to print this up.
Alright, Aaron, I also have two that came in.
You have what?
Two icon relationships that are...
Oh yeah, you do, okay. So I'm at the Elf Queen first. I've got to get that. Just a sec. Sorry, I didn't get a chance to print this out, so I'm having to scroll through the PDF to get my stuff. that seems perfect. Jay, you noticed that on one of the guards, he actually has an elven cloak still in pretty good condition that you think you can wear. It's about your size.
Okay.
So, So that'll add one to your physical defense.
Okay.
And it will add 10 to your checks to remain hidden in natural surroundings. I'll post this in chat.
Okay.
Hopefully next week I will have a better option for this.
And so it's plus 10 to checks for...
To remain hidden in natural surroundings.
Okay.
I'm about to post that, too. And finally, the quirk is you prefer the finest things in life, which are, of course, Elven.
Mm-hmm.
Which seems fitting, considering that was a conflicted role for the Elf Queen. All right, next. Daniel, you got Priestess and Crusader, right?
Yes, 6 with the Priestess, 5 with the Crusader.
All right, so for the Priestess, you don't use a shield, do you?
Yes, I do.
You use a shield, okay. You will get a shield of protection. It's actually got the symbol of the Priestess on it.
Since I have described in my equipment history... my shield engraved with the face of my god, could it just have been blessed by the Priestess and I just realized it's magical?
That works fine. All right, here's the magical property for it. And the quirk is... Oh, this should be interesting. You tend to others with a little too much familiarity. That should be fun. And you also get... You get what you recognize as a it'll come out, I'm sure it will. It's a healing potion, and you recognize it from being a stash from the Crusader, and you know that it tastes really, really vile, as in, you know, like warm vomit, more or less. It works really well, but it tastes like warm vomit.
Okay.
So add a healing potion to yourself.
Okay.
And, all right, who else do we have? I know, Joel, you said you had two?
Yeah, it was...
What's the five?
The five is with the Crusader, and the six is with the Abolist. But she's, you know, hers is a conflicted relationship.
Okay, that's conflicted. And playing
that ring. They both are, actually.
No, that's not it. All right, I'll do it like this. No, that won't work very well. All right, so you'll get the Helm of the Undaunted Hero as your bonus. That's the description text. Here is the actual the effects for it. And the quirk is, this should be fun. You favor traditional battle hymns.
Yeah. Okay.
And you also find one of those really vile and nasty Crusader cachet potions, healing potions. Who didn't get anything so far? Gerald and Gordon?
I've got a five for the priestess conflict.
Oh, you got a five for the priestess. Okay. Gerald, since you hadn't got anything, you find a rune of power that will have an effect that I'll give it to you in a second. As soon as I do that.
Power.
Rune of power. Rune. Let's find out what it is, shall we? This is a weapon rune, so...
Does it talk?
Maybe. 72.
It does something interesting to your weapon for a little while.
The weapon does an additional d10 of damage when the escalation die is at 3 or higher. Unfortunately, this one doesn't talk.
Because my loot does, and I can't have that many voices in my head. It's confusing.
Yes,
okay.
It is.
So, Aaron.
Yes.
Looking at the shield of protection in the loot list, they forgot to apply the default bonus to it, the default HP bonus.
Should
go ahead and do that?
Yeah, go ahead and take it out of the book.
Okay.
Which let me look at that real quick, just so I know what it is.
It's a plus four at Adventurer. It's on page 291.
Oh, there it is. Yeah, that's fine. So I didn't realize that either. I should have done. And Gordon gets something from the priestess. Conflicted. What was your relationship with the priestess, Gordon?
Conflicted. My mom was a priestess cleric.
I'll be right back, guys.
Okay. Yeah, everybody go ahead and take a break right now, except for Gordon, who I have to tell your stuff. Go get something to drink, go to the bathroom, whatever. As soon as everybody gets back, we'll start it again.
5 minutes?
Yeah, we can do 5 minutes.
I said she'd appreciate time to get stuff done around the house.
I mean, basically, my mom loves me and all, but, you know, she wants me to be unswervingly good, and I know that's not what's best.
Okay, and what are your other relationships?
High Druid is positive, and Lich King is conflicted.
Yeah. He's on the email, but so Aaron.
Uh-huh.
It's not letting me edit Rocknar's default total HP.
Really?
To reflect that.
All right. I'll change that for you. I'm not sure why it's not letting you edit this stuff. You should be allowed to. The player commissions are there. So.
Yeah.
All right. So I've changed that for you. So you're up to 32. I had that. Okay. I will give. Gordon, you find a staff. You find a staff of vengeance, and it just. It's a brutal. It's not just your typical wooden staff. It's a war staff, and it feels. And it feels like it's something that's made to hurt people. And I hit click the wrong damn button again. And it's not letting me copy and paste. There we are. All right, so here's the description. And here's the bonus.
Okay.
And the quirk. The quirk is you're quick to take offense. So, I will be right back myself if there's any questions or anything like that. So, just a sec.
I doubt it. We're halfway through. Well, we shouldn't have to do the character creation stuff, so it should go quicker next time.
Oh, and we also have our macros and stuff set up too, so.
Yeah.
That'll help.
Yep. Yeah, I have a macro for, let's see, skills, basic melee with one of my buffs, both of my spells, basic melee with another one of my buffs, basic melee with both of my buffs, and my saves macroed, just in case.
All right, I'm back. Who's still missing?
Do.
Yeah, in this case, Daniel, it's a melee weapon. It's not a.
Okay. Whatever. Oh, right, because he's a monk.
Yep. Yeah, it's not a shoot people with things.
It's not a. So it's a magical staff, but it's not a caster's staff.
Yeah, it's more of a quarter staff.
It is a bow staff.
Yeah. There we go. Confused.
And now that means I need to.
It's a
edit all my
magic
macros.
Stick.
Yes, it's a magic stick.
It's not a staff. It's a magic stick.
It's a magic stick that hurts people.
Yes. Well, then again, everything is... The other staffs are magic sticks that hurt people, too. It's just...
Yes, but it hurts them directly.
Yeah. Well, that's actually something interesting, if they should specifically notate in the monk whether that their staff is somehow different.
Well, it says it's something different. Temple staff or something like that, doesn't it?
Well, to use it with any benefit, you have to be a temple weapon master. So, you know.
Well, the benefit of temple weapon master is just that your fist attacks are 2d8 instead of 2d6.
Right.
Well, d8 per level.
Yeah. Right.
Instead of d6.
We're going to need you to go through a background check before we can give you this stick. There's a 2-week waiting period.
Well, he is a half-orc, so he's kind of a dangerous sort of fellow.
Oh, believe me, Vraknar is registered in several civilizations.
I can't believe you used Ragnar and civilization in the same sentence.
Ragnar actually likes civilizations.
Ragnar loves civilization. More people to
come. Kalud is kind of iffy on them, but he knows how to get around.
They all burn.
Okay, everybody here, everybody ready to go?
Yep, I'm set.
All right. So, you guys have had a chance to rest, catch your breath, and then you notice that the tunnel that you guys are in is starting to collapse. And as it is, you see up here at the north, you see a prisoner that actually, you see a glowing object in his hand, and those of you who weren't prisoners, which I don't think is any of you, you recognize it as the key to the magical barrier that's keeping the prisoners in. And he sprints up here. If anybody needs to do a recharge, go ahead and do that now. I forgot. He sprints in these tunnels up here to the north. He sprints right past you, going from right to left. But he has the key that you guys need to get out of here. So, we're going to do this montage style. Okay. Yes, get him. All right, we're going to start with Joel on this one. Go ahead and describe an obstacle or a danger that you guys encountered down here, but you either avoided it or beat it, or defeated it, I should say.
You mean in the tunnels, like a monster or something?
Just describe some kind of obstacle or danger, just describe the danger itself. Don't tell me how you beat it.
And this is... These crevices open up in the ground that are preventing our progress through the tunnels.
Okay. Jay, how did you get everybody past those crevices?
Crevices are in the ground?
Yes. Well, they're probably all over, but the ground are the most pressing ones.
I was able to find kind of footholds along the wall, you know, being able to recognize sturdy outcroppings and stuff, and I'm able to kind of help chain people across some of the crevices and stuff. You know, hanging onto the wall and basically taking their hand and pulling them across and.
Okay. All right. So you're your quick thinking and helping everybody get past these crevices kept you up with the running prisoner with the key. And in fact, you guys have gained ground on him because he had to work harder to get past these than you guys did.
Okay.
So good job, Jay. Now it's your turn to describe an obstacle that you guys got past or defeated down here.
We see a trio of prisoners. Two of them just kind of heavy looking guys, and there's another guy behind him who's kind of thinner, and he's obviously some kind of spellcaster.
Okay. Gordon, how did you get everybody past this?
I ran forward towards the two front guys with my staff in both hands. I slammed the two guys in the head and did a backflip over the line and then smashed the caster in the head.
All right. So these guys were clearly trying to help protect their prisoner buddy, but you beat them so fast and got past them so fast that the guy you're chasing, who kind of slowed down to watch the carnage, you guys made up some good time on him. Now, Gordon, describe an obstacle or danger.
Okay. The ground suddenly opens up in front of the party, and there's about a 10-foot-wide gap that goes down into who knows what between us and the guy who's escaping.
Okay. Gerald, describe how you got everybody past that.
I grabbed one of the small orc children, hurled him over the crevice, grasping it so he could grasp at a pole, once I tied a rope across him, of course. And then we quickly clambered across the rope, me first being the lighter of anybody. And we were very grateful to the orc child, so we decided not to throw him into the crevice.
All right. Your unexpected use of human resources or
half orc resources.
Yes. Has gained you a great deal of ground on the fleeing prisoner. And he's so close now that you can practically touch him, but he moves faster than you, so he's maintaining his lead. Now, Gerald, it's your turn to describe an obstacle that the party defeated down here.
I don't know. I really don't.
There's a purplish ooze on the floor that's just covering all of the stones.
Okay. And Daniel, how did Rocknar get everybody past that?
I'm sorry, what was the obstacle?
There's a glowing purple ooze.
Glowing purple ooze.
About a quarter inch of it. All across the slick floor.
Slick floor. Rocknar, in a rare moment of piety, goes all Moses on the ooze, raising his mace and channeling the holy power of beatings, and the ooze just cravenly moves aside, afraid of him.
All right, I like that one. That's good. So, Daniel, your turn to describe the last obstacle that you guys faced.
The final obstacle before catching this guy is he sees we come to a split hallway, and he ducks around one direction, and we don't see which way he went.
All right, and Joel, how did you get everybody past that problem?
We start ducking through tunnels and it's just kind of like spider web where you look to your left and sometimes you'll see him run down a corridor just like, like the corner of your eye. You chase him only to see him run across another one. And it's at one of those moments, and I narrate the success.
Yeah, you don't have to roll. Just go ahead and tell me how you do it.
And at this moment that when the prisoner is running past one of these kind of like spiderweb catacombs, Velnard takes a shot with the hand crossbow, impaling his hand to the rock wall.
Okay. He manages to pull it out just as you're getting close to him, but as you turn the corner to find where he went, you see that he's slumped down on the floor, face first, and he's been burnt to death. It looks like that the crystals, your shot that impaled him into the wall, it made this discharge from the crystals boil out and burn him to death. He's got purple smoke rising from his eyes, and he's still got the key clutched into his hands.
Ragnar, would you like to get that?
Ragnar is not afraid of puny arcane magics, and Ragnar will just pry the guy's hand open, ripping fingers off if need be, and take the key.
Okay. The key is basically it's a D8 basically in shape, with runes on each facing side. And it's glowing faintly, the same color of gold that you recognize as the barrier keeping the prisoners in. And it takes you guys a little while to find another hole in the opening in the island in Darkskye. But after you do, you're in this tunnel, and you see if in the distance you see bright light, normal light, not this bizarre purple light crystals have been given off, and through that light you see something green, and you know that it's a tree, and somehow the tree has gotten stuck into the island itself. You guys have drifted down far enough that the island is at the level of the highest trees, and given the way that the island is moving around and shifting and turning, you're pretty sure it's not going to stay that way for long. It may actually start to rise again. It may crash and collapse with you guys in it. So your best bet, you know, is to get through there immediately.
Ragnar recommends jumping from moving vehicle.
Not a bad idea.
Tuck and roll.
All right.
Ragnar goes first.
All right, you guys are running towards it?
Yep.
All right. As you're running towards it, you hear this rumbling sound, this sound that you've actually heard before earlier in this escapade, and it's a sound of water rushing, except this isn't just a little bit of water. This sounds like a lot of water. This sounds like the lake has finally completely let go, and not only that, but all those internal reservoirs have also probably let go, and they're going to come out and sweep you out if you don't hurry. It is completely clearing out these tunnels, so go ahead and make me a swimming roll to see how if you guys take any damage.
What do you want added to this?
Go ahead and roll a constitution or strength, depending on what you guys want to do.
Okay.
Not dexterity?
No, not dexterity, not for this. Because this is basically sweeping aside a is trying to avoid being smashed by a wall of water. That's a lovely one you rolled there, Jay. Well done. Well done indeed.
Yep.
All right, there's 17.
I apparently tried to take a deep breath right as the wall of water hit me or something.
Okay, so we have 22, we have 14, 7. Who are we missing still?
Would my zealous energy be able to assist me in plowing through this rapid water?
I think that's fitting.
Okay.
25. Wow, you were really well on that. All right, so anybody that rolled more than a 15, you are able to negotiate the wall of water with great skill and or enthusiasm. In the case of Rachnar, I'm sure. He's like, I'm going to punch a wall of water, and you won.
I don't want to lead it too much, but with like the red monk kind of like, I imagine all that Shaolin temple training, would that somehow relate?
What did you roll for yours?
A modified 14.
Well, I mean, what background did you roll for it?
I didn't add anything. I just added my comp.
What are your other backgrounds again?
The backgrounds were the red monk, the witch hunter, and the cultist.
I think the monk's probably fitting. The other two, not so much.
Okay. So then that does put him over 15 at an 18.
Okay. So, I mean, the only person who failed is Jay, and let's see how much damage Jay takes.
Dwarves can't swim.
No.
You take 6 damage from as you're smashed into rocks, as you guys are all kind of washed out past the tree. Tabar is washed down considerably farther with the rest of you guys. He's up to his neck in mud. He doesn't smell very good because it's not very nice mud. So you guys are basically riding a waterfall out of this island into a forest. And as far as you guys can see, you guys are in the wild wood. It goes on as far as you can see. There's no other forest besides the Elf Queen's Forest. Which is this big in the Empire, and you guys know that you're not even close to the elven courts. The island has dumped a whole bunch of those glowing crystals into the forest. You can see some of them, but you can also see evidence that they've been dropped all over the place. From where you guys are at, which is still dozens of feet up in the air. You can see a village in the distance. It's not incredibly close. It's probably a few hours' walk from where you guys are being swept out right now. And in the far, far distance, you guys can see a road. It's probably the road that leads to Newport. And all over the forest, you can see those the trees crushed by rock and the glowing rocks. And they're actually still falling from the sky. And that's where we end off for the night, or the afternoon, I should say. So normally you guys would get a full heal up, but in this case you do not. So don't adjust anything, not until next time. Let's see, is there anything else I need to do before... Nope, we're pretty much done for today. So, are there any questions, comments, criticisms, things you want to bring up?
Like the D20 tool.
Yeah, I like Roll 20. It works. It takes a little bit to get used to and to tame and get past some of the crappier features. But once it's actually working, it works really well.
Yeah.
So, like, all these, these status bars that you have, all this is just available, like, if I wanted to run a game, all this would be accessible to me. I don't have to do anything.
Basically. I have a little bit more accessible for me because I'm technically a backer. I'm technically a paid account on here. You didn't see any of those things that I get that free people don't get. Everything that I did today, you can do with a free account. You can go in there and run an account, no problem whatsoever. The major limitation on free accounts is really how much space you have available to upload stuff. But even then, generally it's not a problem as long as your maps aren't disgustingly huge and you don't have hundreds and hundreds of huge token images. Which I don't see how you could. I do have over 100 tokens on here, and it takes up almost no space whatsoever. So the free accounts, you can do pretty much everything I did today, you can do with them.
Okay.
So is this map part of the adventure, or is this one you came up with somewhere else?
No, this one. This I actually I went and found for demos for one of the demos that I do.
Okay.
And I can't remember where I got this. I think this is this might be a Paizo map. It's not an official. It's either Paizo or D&D. I can't remember. But here, let me show it. Let me put it on screen for everybody who's watching or will be watching later. And there's the map. I just uploaded this. I make my own maps, but it takes a long time to do, or it can take a long time to do. So right. I'll go out there and I'll search for maps on DeviantArt, on Google Image Search. There's lots of websites, as Daniel has pointed out, that have maps that are free or cheap. Some of them are better than others. This is a really good one. But I can't claim the map as my own. I only found it and uploaded it. All the tokens I made the tokens, but the art was not mine either. I found it, again, on DeviantArt and Google Image Search, and obviously you guys sent me your art to use for that.
And Roll20, doesn't Roll20 supposed to have, like, a collection of art you can use for tokens and stuff?
It does, but most of that is... I'm not sure how much they have in the way of free, but they do have... I'll see if I can put up anything. I might not be able to. But they have stuff. It's not like... Most of their stuff isn't, like, tokens. It's more like... more like actual minis... And you're looking down at them from the top.
Oh, okay.
That's what the stuff that they offer is, and it's most of it's you have to pay for. And I do have a bunch of that again as part of I won't get into it, but I have a bunch of that, but I don't really use it because I don't like the look as much as I do tokens. I think tokens look even if they're less realistic. I like looking at characters' faces. I like looking at their faces. I don't like looking at minis top down. It's not as interesting to me. So I use those instead.
Yeah, I feel the same way.
Roll20 is a really great tool. I love using it. I've put in I don't know how many hours using Roll20. It's a really good tool. It takes a little bit to get used to as a GM. Part of why this went so well tonight is because I spent a lot of time prepping, and I've had a lot of experience getting things to go with other games and stuff like that. So I know exactly what to do and how to do it. But it's not too hard. It's not the hardest thing in the world. It's mostly the technical problems that are. That everybody runs into, and we've gotten most of those taken care of tonight. I mean, that next session should go. We should be able to start, pretty much right away. Yeah, I preload maps and I preload all the tokens. I mean, if you guys could, I'll even show you, because it doesn't really matter at this point. Is I put all the tokens down on the board as soon as the map is ready and reveal areas. And you can see if there had been more of you here, you would have seen these enemies down here.
Oh, okay.
So I put the maximum number of tokens that I might use on there when I'm doing my prep, and then I just cover them up with fog of war or something like that. So that it makes it easier. And I tried to do a pre-rolled initiative too, but that didn't work. You guys didn't get to the other fight, which is kind of a good thing, because there was 31 fucking enemies in that fight. I'll go ahead and move you guys over, and I'll show you the other encounter that you guys. I just went and skipped it for time. I didn't think it's a nice encounter, but it's not. It doesn't add a lot. I think that you tremendously miss. When you guys are running through the crystal, that last part of it, you guys would have fought all of that.
Holy crap.
So, actually, you had fought... I don't remember. There's 30 there, though, and there's... you guys would have fought 20 of them. If there were six of you, if Bree had been able to be in here, you would have fought all of those. But those are level zero mooks, so it's not a...
Right.
They're not horrible.
Are they mooks?
Yeah, crystal golems and the shardlings. Which is it's a nasty fight, don't get me wrong, but I figured it's a nice fight, but I don't think it adds a whole lot that I need it to do. So, but the golem... Well,
if I could get myself surrounded by crystallings, I could have done, I could have done some serious blowing up.
Yeah, it's not so much the...
Oh, yeah.
It's not so much the crystallings that are the problem, it's the golem. Golem is a level 6 wrecker, I think. And
yeah, that sounds right.
level 6 wrecker. His basic attack is 11 versus AC twice in a round. And the first natural even or miss, hit or miss, he gets to do it again. He is vulnerable to thunder, but I'm not sure you guys have a lot of thunder attacks. I think you can potentially have some, though.
Yeah, only the sorcerer would potentially have thunder if he rolls correctly on his chaos bolt.
Yeah, he's vicious. He has 90 hit points, too.
Jeez.
So, it's a really interesting fight. I mean, I don't mean to... By saying that I don't think it added a lot, I don't mean to denigrate it and say it's a bad fight. I think it's a good fight. It's just, it's one you can easily skip and not feel like you missed anything. Really, really important to the adventure. So, I think that's about it, though. Anybody else have any other questions or comments or anything going on? What is your opinion about Greece?
It's wonderful on a hamburger.
I still think that's great. That's made
that's hilarious.
Worth it right then and there. So, all right. So in that case, I'll go ahead and end it off here. I will end the broadcast. So everybody, go ahead and say bye.
Bye. Thanks.
Bye. Bye.